wail of the whistle. It is at the same time incredibly lonely and incredibly promising. It cries of trips to other places, of broad plains and craggy mountains, of distant oceans and huge cities. Watch the power. Watch the giant tube of iron and steel pull a mile-long kingdom of people and material. Watch the roaring smokestack and the thumping pistons, strong and unstoppable. Feel the earth shake as the iron dinosaur thunders past you. Feel the cascade of pure steam as the engine shoots beneath the bridge. For more than a century, railroads carried the lifeblood of our country, a nation with veins of steel. The heart of that system was the most exquisite creation of the industrial age, a machine at once useful and beautiful, the steam engine. Elegantly ugly, incredibly powerful. A complex machine that drew power from the simplest source and transformed it into churning wheels and pounding pistons. Even the names of the engines inspired awe-filled poetry and dreams. Niagara, Mogul, Texas, General, Mikado, Challenger. Some of these locomotives were more famous than U.S. presidents, and often more useful. The history of steam trains is the history of America, from the crude beginnings in the early 1800s, through the conquering of the nation's frontier, to modern 20th century civilization. I was only a boy in the last days of steam, but I loved those trains. And I wasn't alone. Generations of boys became men before me, and all grew up loving those vast machines, big and mean and loud and strong. We love them, and we wish that one day, maybe just one time, we'd get to sit in that cab with our hand on that throttle, 100 tons of power thundering around us. It was a great dream. To understand the romance and power of a steam engine, you have to first understand how it worked and how steam was used. If you used your X-ray vision on a locomotive engine, you'd see that the largest part of it was a boiler, where white-hot fire turned water into evaporated steam. It is simply a metal tank with a firebox at one end. A network of pipes, often more than a mile if laid end to end, crisscross this firebox and the water is superheated. The result is steam in enormous quantities, filling 1,600 times the amount of space as the water needed to make it. Enclose that in an airtight compartment and direct that pressure to a cylinder, and you have a basic steam engine. Excess steam and smoke were pushed through pipes to the front of the engine and discharged into the air through the smokestack. Despite what a lot of people think, those huge columns of vapor from a locomotive were not smoke, but mostly water vapor, steam in a cooled form. This steam power was then transformed into mechanical energy through a system of cylinders, connecting rods, pistons, and wheels. In this cutaway model, you see a simple version of a steam engine at work. The power stroke begins when the valve allows steam to flow into the cylinder. This expanding force pushes the connecting piston to the other end of the cylinder. In the meantime, the valve moves the other way, allowing the steam to push the piston back. Rods link this push-pull movement to the drive wheels. That means the force of each piston stroke reaches each drive wheel at the same time. But steam power not only drove the wheels, it supplied power for every other part of the train in every way. The steam whistle was the voice of the engine. It warned trespassers off the rails and signaled to the train crew and those at trackside. Atop the boiler was a small steam-driven generator supplying electrical power for the headlight, telegraph, and various accessories. 2 pumps supplied power for the brake equipment and bell ringer. Strong reservoirs held the air at a level 140 pounds per square inch. The brakes were iron shoes held against the wheels by air pressure. A twist of the engineer's wrist, and these thick metal parts applied friction to the monstrous drive wheels, wheels often taller than a grown man. And when the rails were slippery because of rain or snow, sand was sprayed between the wheel and the rail, again, sprayed by steam power. But the steam engine began much simpler. Decades before America declared her independence, a Scotsman named James Watt developed a crude water pump which could be used to drive a machine. Inventors from England, France, and America improved on the idea, and the concept of rail tracks were introduced. These first small, cumbersome engines, like the best friend of Charleston, the Tom Thumb, and the DeWitt Clinton, gradually replaced the slow-moving barges on the canals in the eastern United States. Scoffers claimed that smooth driving wheels against smooth metal rails would just spin futilely. They were wrong. They had not counted on the great weight of the engine. The John Bull was imported from England by Robert L. Stevens for the Camden and Amboy Railroad in New Jersey. Stevens also designed the T-rail, which became the basis of all rail track in America and the world. The elegance of riding the coach car was dampened only a little by the frequent stops, when, often as not, passengers would have to climb out and help stock the woodpile. And to put the brakes on, the engineer had only to lean out the window, then yell at the brakeman sitting atop a shelter in the tender. To move produce and material from one end of the country to the other, it'd often have to be shipped round the lower tip of South America. But railroads could provide a better way. The birth of railroads came simultaneously with the westward expansion of the United States. In fact, one of the South's greatest cities began because of the railroad. The state of Georgia laid track to connect itself with the Tennessee River. This railroad began in the middle of nowhere in a pine ridge. At first, they simply called the spot Terminus. Then Marthasville. Eventually, this railroad hub became known as the City of Atlanta. These early railroads were expensive propositions, buying the rights to land, hiring men to lay the track, investing in locomotives that could cost $10,000 to $20,000 apiece. That in an age when a loaf of bread cost a penny, and an acre of land could run you as much as $10 or $20. Throughout the 1800s, the federal government granted land to the train companies at dirt-cheap prices in exchange for a series of iron railroads that would knit the far-flung nation together. It was a way to subsidize progress. The steam engine made it possible for farmers in the South and the Midwest to receive tools and machinery and to get their produce to big city markets back east while it was still fresh. To move mountains of raw minerals from the quarries and mines to the factories and mills, and to move people. The old-fashioned covered wagon still made that long trek out west, but more and more, people simply bought their tickets and arrived a few days later. The railroads did great good for the nation, but the railroad tycoons were not in business for their health. Yes, they were entrepreneurs, pioneers, risk-takers, but often as not, they were outright thieves and crooks on a colossal scale, transmitting orders from ornate business castles like this. There was Collis Huntington, who had no more soul than a shark, or the infamous Jay Gould, who left to his son an estate worth $681 million in 1892. The value of that in today's dollars is beyond measure. But a lot of folks thought the railroad men were the real robbers, and they decided to fight back. Throughout the wilds of Missouri, bandits like Frank and Jesse James, the Younger Brothers, and the Cole Brothers made daring attacks on moving trains. Though these robbers killed in the course of their crimes, they still became the stuff of legends, Robin Hoods of the Old West. Any railroad that didn't include the word Pacific in its name was hardly respectable. Something about the name inspired a dream of transcontinental travel, of manifest destiny. There was the Atlantic and Pacific, Kansas Pacific, Georgia Pacific, Southern Pacific, Northern Pacific, Central Pacific, Union Pacific, even the Tennessean Pacific, which started in Nashville and ran east. Mostly, though, it was wishful thinking. Steam could tie the country together, but this was only an expensive dream in the early 1860s. There were three proposed routes from east to west: a northern route through the Great Plains, and from the Deep South through Arizona Territory. All three proposed rail paths would have to cross distances like no man-made road had ever done, and all three would have to broach the great Rocky Mountains. But planning and surveying took a long time. Trains sat waiting for new road. The Union Pacific decided on the middle route, laying track west from Council Bluffs, Iowa. At the same time, Central Pacific laid track down from San Francisco eastward into the mountains. But the war slowed down this progress, slowed it down to a crawl. The southern states were like a nation apart from the industrial north, a land of plantations and crinoline gowns, of vast orchards and respected universities, of landed gentry sipping mint juleps on broad green lawns. But the cotton plantations of the south ran on slave labor. 11 southern states withdrew from the Union and formed the Confederacy, a new nation which sought to preserve their way of life, their peculiar institutions. The 13th president of the U.S., Abraham Lincoln, sought to preserve the union of all states. And so the two nations began the American Civil War. The war between the states was the first railroad war. Men, guns, and supplies went to the battlefront with speed unimaginable 20 years before. The most exciting episode of warfare on the rails was the Great Locomotive Chase of 1862. The General was a beautiful 440 American-class locomotive, the pride of the Western and Atlantic Railway. Union Army Captain J.J. Andrews and a team of soldiers in civilian clothes snuck into Georgia and stole the General, racing away to the north. They planned to sabotage southern railways and bridges and cut the enemy supply lines. Rebel soldiers and engineers pursued them, first on foot, then on hand cars, and finally aboard a second locomotive, the Texas. 60 years later, silent comedian Buster Keaton recreated this true-life adventure. Keaton himself loved trains from full-size to scale models, and made sure his recreations of the Texas and the General were accurate. The comedy, of course, was 100% Keaton. Thank you. feature was made in 1926, there were plenty of old steam engines. No one gave it a second thought to destroy one in the process of filming a big action scene. In the general, the South also collapsed, and the war was over. One positive thing that came out of the war was train safety. Because of the heavy locomotive traffic, a system of semaphore signals was worked out to make sure trains could avoid collision. And most times it worked. A standard track width was established so that passengers and freight did not have to be transferred from one train to the other when the gauge of the rails changed. 4 feet, 8 1/2 inches became known as standard gauge, though some short lines and spur lines stayed with narrow gauge. Parts of the South were content with a 5-foot width until late in the century. On one incredible day in May 1886, thousands of miles of 5-foot wide track were narrowed to standard gauge. By sundown, the incredible task was completed. The confusion of names and numbers of engines was simplified with the White system of classification. This took its cue from the number of guide wheels, drive wheels, and trailing wheels. An American style had 2 pair of guide wheels, 2 pair of drivers, and no wheels in the rear, which made it a 440. This classic shape, with a single pair of guide wheels, 2 pair of drivers, and 2 trailing wheels, would be a 242. And this 20th century brute, with 2 guide wheels, a double set of 8 drivers, and a single pair of trailing wheels, is a 2882. With thousands of men from the North and South free for military service, the rail companies went full bore into linking East with West, not just for the glory, but for the money. A competitive market brought prices down, but if only one railway served an area, why, they could charge anything they wanted. Every one of those companies wanted to be that railway. Most of the Central Pacific work gangs were Chinese, chosen for their diligent work and the fact that the railroad companies didn't have to pay them a lot of money. Mistrust and bigotry ran riot. On the Union Pacific side and working west, the road gangs were mostly Irish immigrants and ex-soldiers, men who loved drinking, fighting, and chasing women, not in that order. The Union Pacific hated the Central Pacific, the Central hated the Union, the Irish hated the Chinese. Often as not, the arguments were settled with dynamite. They finally linked up on May 10th, 1869, in the desert near Promontory, Utah. Engine number 119 from the east and the Jupiter out of San Francisco steamed toward each other. The presidents of both companies drove 2 symbolic spikes, a gold one from California and a silver one from Nevada. Here, that moment is recreated at the 1939 World's Fair. Afterward, the workers guzzled down $3,000 worth of whiskey, brought in from Frisco by Central Pacific. The telegraph tapped out the news. 1, 2, 3, done. The next 15 years saw other railroads crisscross the country from top to bottom. The Northern Pacific from Lake Superior to Puget Sound, the Great Northern from Duluth to Seattle, the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe, and the Southern Pacific, Texas Pacific. With the accompanying creation of telegraph lines, the railroads had also linked the country together with an electric information system. Hundreds of trains ran day and night. zones were established nationwide to accommodate the train schedules. Even though noon in Philadelphia was 4 minutes later than noon in New York, by law, the times were now the same. The steam engine became stronger, faster, more refined. The balloon stack on top of an old loco like this wasn't just for decoration. The constant fire from the burning wood threw off sparks like the 4th of July. These stacks were shaped wide to catch those sparks and prevent fires through the woods and plains. And they worked, usually. Toward the end of the 19th century, coal began to replace wood. It burned hotter, gave off less sparks. And as these iron brutes became bigger and hungrier, the tender became more than just a trailer. The 20th century coal bin of a powerful locomotive provided enough fuel to run the engine hundreds of miles. On the largest locomotives, even two men could not shovel coal fast enough to develop full power on a boiler. A device called the Archimedes screw in the base of the tender brought coal forward into the engine, crushing indigestible lumps along the way. As the coal emerged from the tender, jets of steam sprayed the coal to all parts of the firebox, controlled by valves in the cab. The power of the engine to pull a mile or more of train was transmitted car to car by a steel knuckle called a coupler. Prior to the invention of this device, train cars were held together by chains or linchpins. And each time the locomotive moved abruptly, the jerk could be felt all the way back to the caboose. This flexible but sturdy device transmitted the pulling power but made the motion much smoother. Other flexible couplings hooked the tender to the engine, providing water for the boiler, air for the train brakes, and steam for heating the cars. The great yawning mouths of the steam engines thirsted constantly, drinking 6 barrels of water a minute at high speeds. Here you see engine numbers 495 and 496 of the Denver and Rio Grande, loading up with water. These huge tanks became a fixture throughout America, and were often the tallest structures in very small towns. That's where we get the term tank town. The largest of these steam engines, like the Big Boy, could take up to 14,000 gallons of water at a gulp. To protect the delicate metal guts of the locomotive, water was constantly tested for mineral residue. If too many chemicals were present, technicians would soften the water. Only the best for the snorting iron horse. But tanks required the train to stop. To speed up this process, track pans were developed. Long pans set deep between the rails. Without slowing down, the steam engine sailed over the track pan with a scoop, and the movement of the train itself pushed the water right up into the tender. Schedules got tighter and loads got heavier. Bigger engines were needed. A doubleheader could speed up a mountain delivery or an urgent shipment, but that meant taking a second locomotive out of action as a helper. This 260 first went into action in 1890, a Samson of the rails, with 6 driving wheels to conquer those mountain grades. But that was not enough. 6 drivers became 8, and 8 wheels became 10. As the iron horses grew longer, they needed bigger boilers, bigger cylinders, more steam. Engines gained in strength and length, but they started to outgrow the very tracks they rolled on. The colossal weight of these larger locos smacked heavily against the tracks designed for lighter engines. The rails and spikes shuddered with each thunderous turn of the wheel. The longer the locomotive grew, the more it became like a centipede with a stiff neck. It had difficulty following curves around rivers and mountains. Bridges and tunnels had to be widened. A Frenchman named Anatole Mallet figured out an answer to the problem. In 1889, he built a flexible locomotive. 2 short engine units joined in the middle with a hinge pin. He also added an extra pair of drive cylinders to the rear unit. A large boiler that stretched the length of both front and rear units completed the design. The railroad world now had the makings of an engine powerful enough to pull the longest trains, but agile enough to take curves without getting stuck. These new engine styles were called articulated because of the center hinge. This meant they could be longer, distributing the weight over a broader area on more wheels. As the 20th century began, steam locomotives were the height of power and mechanical beauty. There was a wonderful combination of romance and solid toughness to a train. Elegance and pure power. Power you could see in the churning wheels, in the huffing of the smokestack. Much of the steam locomotive's life was spent near its home, the roundhouse. In the center was a vast turntable used to steer the engines into their own berth. Never-ending job was removing the ashes from the firebox. And of course, the locos would get regular washings and overhauls. Steam connections would be checked for leaks. Then into the shop. Most maintenance was done in a few hours, but major repairs could take a month or more. Here, a Union Pacific big boy, the biggest engine ever built, is disassembled for maintenance. The back shop was in charge of new tires, smoothing away the rugged and pitted surface with precision tools, then remounting. The tires were about an eighth of an inch smaller in diameter than the wheel. With a flame hoop of gas, the tire expanded to fit, and when it was hammered into place, no one could complain about these shoes feeling too loose. Tubes and flues were checked in the boiler, as well as the piping that made up the superheater. In Big Boy, more than a mile of piping. On this 4000 class, the mechanical parts all seemed huge, as if created by giants. Inspectors used their sense of hearing and touch to check for leaks and loose parts. To check for air leaks, they'd use torches to watch for telltale drafts coming from pipes. The process of motion pictures made use of locomotives from the very beginning of that industry. Trains added visual excitement as early as the great train robbery made in 1903. Fight scenes atop moving trains were as common as showdowns at high noon. Sometimes it was hard to figure out whether the locomotive was supposed to be a big prop, a performer, or even a location. In 1917, shadows of the Great War in Europe started to darken the cities of America. A lot of people said it wasn't our business, a foreign war in faraway countries. But American boys signed up in patriotic fervor. And during those years of the First World War, the U.S. government called the train system to work in moving doughboys from every part of the nation to ships headed for the European battlefield. Armistice was declared, American boys returned to a country alive with steam power. It was the golden age of steam. You could stand and watch the great machines and dream of riding anywhere in the country. You knew that the distant moving serpent of boxcars and flat cars led to every city and town you'd read about and dreamed about. The engineer's whistle beckoned you. A siren called romance and adventure. And if you couldn't afford to board, then you could stand on an underpass and feel the blast of steam power around you. Feel the shaking power of the engine below. Watch the vapor envelop you like clouds of a dream. In New York, the New York Central consolidated hundreds of smaller railways into one magnificent system. The NYC had 300 of these giant Hudson types running on their tracks. Likewise, out west, lines like the Southern Pacific and the Santa Fe crossed the rugged deserts of Arizona and Nevada. On the Chicago and Northwestern, rugged little E2s pulled everything from small locals to lengthy freights along the picturesque causeway near Sterling. cars like this one pulling the 49er train. And in the mountains, even heavy snows could not stop the push and pull of motive power. A spiderweb of steel crisscrossed the nation. To Flint, Dearborn, and Detroit, where automobiles were born and soon covered the nation's roads. But when the Great Depression struck in 1929, the railroads were hurt as badly as everyone else in America. Rail yards sat vacant, quiet as graveyards. The few trains that were running often had jobless hobos sneaking rides on the rails. Passenger traffic dwindled in favor of cars, and trucks began to take over some of the transportation of goods. The burgeoning airplane industry also took a growing piece of the travel pie. But in the mid-1930s, as Franklin Roosevelt created the New Deal, railroads created their new look, streamlining.
Streamliner on the cross-country run. She's using the same pre-tested oil.
Not everybody knew quite what to make of these newfangled engines. But something about the new style made people want to get back on board. Rail travel shot back up like never before. Stations once again filled with the scuffle of feet, the hoarse voice calling out departure times, the partings, and the reunions. Many famous engines were refitted with new aluminum or steel shrouds to become reborn as a streamliner. Teardrop shapes that cut down on wind resistance, but most of all, appealed to the eye. The interiors of these new train cars were like cities on rails, with restaurant cars, sleeping facilities, telephones, bars. Traveling by rail was the most comfortable and elegant mode of transportation. Trains sliced through the night at full speed, highballing to their next destination while the passengers ate, slept, read, or played cards. It was as if the state of Missouri was moving, not the train. The New York Central's famed 20th Century Limited looked beautiful and powerful even before the streamlined design was added by Henry Dreyfuss. The Milwaukee Road boasted a fleet of 464s designed by Otto Hueller, a streamlined Hiawatha running from Chicago to the Twin Cities, was called the world's most popular train running on the Milwaukee Road. Thank you. there was the Pacific Limited, pulling a load of passenger cars. Steam trains were still the universal method of transportation all over the world. In England particularly, it was said you could set your watch to the whistle of the trains. Depots like Victoria Station became as famous as New York's Grand Central. English trains ran day and night to keep the island nation alive. The birthplace of America's first engines kept refining the art of steam. And as in America, the locos in Britain delivered everything, from mail to people to Jersey milk. Always a dramatic sight, the moving platforms and cars of a roaring steam engine often provided exciting backdrops for mysteries, like Agatha Christie's Murder on the Orient Express, Ian Fleming's From Russia with Love, the Sherlock Holmes stories. In this early Alfred Hitchcock thriller, the romance and danger of the rails was heard for the first time. The clickety-clack of rail ties beneath the wheels, the constant chug of the powerful pistons, the wail of the whistle splitting the night. Pride and joys were the Princess Coronation class engines, built in 1938. The massive boiler for this modern 462 engine, number 6207, had a great area of 45 square feet and lots of tubing. As with most streamliners, the casing made daily maintenance more difficult when you had to get behind this teardrop-shaped metal shell. American rail fans had heard about the Coronation and asked for it to appear at the New York World's Fair in 1939. What the British sent instead was the Duchess, an identical sister train, with a new nameplate that said Coronation. To pass American standards, a warning bell was fitted and a headlight. When the engine was raised for its voyage across the Atlantic, it almost plopped into the River Thames. The dock workers managed to get it back on track. Whether Coronation Scott or Duchess, the engine toured America and looked fine. War broke out in 1939 and the engine remained in America, being seen by over 3 million people, until it was shipped back to England in 1942 for the war effort. The celebration of trains at the New York World's Fair was a steam lover's dream. The New York Central's first streamliner, the J3A, was there, and Canadian National's equally impressive streamliner, built for the visit of the King of England to Canada. There were only 10 of these Dreyfus-designed J3As, with driving wheels a full 79 inches high. These locos were reserved for first-class runs, like the 20th Century Limited. the Baltimore and Ohio showed off their duplex drive engine, the George H. Emerson, a 4444, the only one ever built. And Pensy's pride and joy was this futuristic S1, a 6446, designed by Raymond Loewy, 140 feet long. In the 1930s, a new type of engine raised its streamlined head. Old-timers scoffed at these engines. They moved fast on flatlands with short trains, but it wasn't surprising to see an old steam engine huffing and puffing to help a diesel up a high grade. In the 1930s and 40s, the biggest engines could cost as much as $200,000 each, and a loaf of bread cost 25 cents. I don't have to tell you what a loaf of bread costs today, or what it would cost for a new steam engine. But even after the intrusion of diesel, steam remained a mainstay of the rails, especially along the freight moving department. Here's an Illinois Central 2800 class 2102 coming into Wallace Yard at Freeport, where an Illinois Central 482, engine number 2438, waits for her to pass by. These strong engines are hooked up to reefer cars, refrigerated carriers of food bound for the East Coast. And a muscular 2100 class 482 may start slow, but develops a full head of steam on the way out of the yard. Like the Denver and Rio Grande, transported huge amounts of raw material from Colorado, Nevada, from the 1800s through the 1950s. These engines chugged up the narrow gauge road past breathtaking scenery. Even the strongest of engines often needed extra motive power up these steep grades. Here's a 3600 class articulated. Through the Tennessee Pass, here's a doubleheader, an 1800 class with a 1700 helper. Along this long climb, the trains pass by Camp Hale, an army base where ski troops trained during World War II. After the long S-curve near Mitchell, Colorado, the train ducks through the Tennessee Pass tunnel, and then out to Tennessee Pass Depot. Feel the bite of the cold air and the mountain wind whistling past your face. Even in the summer, the snow clings to the mountainsides and the edges of the icy stream. Steam engines were made for each other. The chill of the air redoubles the amount of water vapor from the vast engines. Here, engines 20 and 41 work out in the train yard at Dolores, Colorado. Number 464, powered by a leased engine, takes the point. And the second engine, number 461, is cut into the middle of the train as a helper. One of the proudest of Southern Pacific locomotives was the Daylight, called the most beautiful train in the world. But the rules of the road have to be obeyed, even by the Daylight, which here pulls into a sidetrack to allow a special to pass on the route from Los Angeles to San Francisco. The strength of this engine stayed legendary long after the last one ran, because of a certain television comparison.
The United States Treasury Department presents The Adventures of Superman.
Faster than a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound.
Look, up in the sky, it's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman.
On December 7th, 1941, the Japanese sneak attack on Pearl Harbor once again plunged the United States into war. Steam engines of every size and shape were harnessed into service. Those that were past their prime were scrapped and made into weapons of war. Their iron and steel reformed to become tanks and cannons and guns. This Illinois Central 400 class 260 lasted until 1942, when it was scrapped for the war effort. The great flat cars now carted tanks instead of autos, troops instead of vacationing visitors. Soldiers and sailors by the hundreds of thousands bid goodbye to loved ones. On land, sea, and air, the Second World War raged on. Amidst worldwide chaos, steam trains remained the arteries and veins through which the blood of nations coursed. Enemy steam trains became a favorite moving target for fighter planes. The supplies they carried could make a strong army fight longer and harder. Destroy the train, and you might cut the war just a little bit shorter. The pilot of this Army Air Force Thunderbolt got a flaming surprise when he hit a bullseye on a boxcar loaded with enemy ammunition. After the war, steam helped usher in an era of growth and prosperity. Throughout the 1940s, a heavy-duty sales pitch was made to the railroads and the public. Diesels were faster and stronger than steam, so said the salesmen. The diesels had improved since their introduction, but whether the claims were true, that's hard to say. Most of the railroads resented the need to throw out their old engines for these new box-shaped locomotives. But that was the wave of the future. Or at least, that's what the diesel salesman said. But there was a last hurrah, the biggest, strongest steam engines ever built. Engineers drew up blueprints for the biggest, grandest steam locomotive of all time. In the 1920s, the articulateds found some competition in the 9000 series. Rigid frame brutes that provided power and speed with 12 coupled driving wheels, running twice as fast as the Malays, yet used less fuel. The 9000 served well on the plains, where rails curved gently, but in mountain country their efficiency dropped. The Challengers and the later refinement, the 3900 class, were different from the Malays in that they used high-pressure steam in two sets of equal-sized cylinders. But when World War II loomed, even the massive Challengers were found wanting. Big Boy was born. The Challenger had two sets of six drivers, but Big Boy raised the ante. Two groups of eight drivers. The family resemblance was still there. Heavy jowls with bulky cylinders. A single cyclopean eye low over a double chin of air compressors. The bell hung down like a forelock, and the pilot covered the lower face like a steel beard. The 4000 series were 132 feet long, weighing in at 1,250,000 pounds. On level track, it could pull a loaded train 5.5 miles long. Big Boy was king of the rails, an irresistible force made of equal parts steam and steel. Rods and wheels flashed and spun, majestic, omnipotent. The Big Boys were the last monarch of steam. As diesel power took over the rails and motor cars became our choice of transportation, the sigh of the steam engine became a fading echo. Those colossal creations of iron, steel, copper, and aluminum were powerless to turn the clock back. The young boys who grew up watching in awe as the huge iron horses passed are grown up now. The thrill of seeing a mammoth steam engine at work has become a memory of childhood. The age of steam is past. It will never be recaptured, no more than a dream. But like the best and most beautiful dreams, we remember it long after it is gone.